I'm Norman Wildberger. Today we're going to talk about complex numbers introduced in the 16th century and a source of mystery and magic for centuries afterwards. Our approach is going to be to think about complex numbers in a geometrical way. Let's start by looking at the Cartesian plane and making sure we understand the distinction between a point, like this point, 3, 2, right there, and a vector, like this one here, the vector 1, 3. A vector is a directed line segment, while a point, of course, is just a dot. And a directed line segment or vector doesn't change if we translate it. So that vector and that vector and that vector are all the same. This is the standard position of the vector when its tail is at the origin. And in that way, the head of the vector aligns with the point, so we get an identification of points and vectors. But for us, it's going to be useful to keep these two notions separate. There's two things that vectors have that points don't have. First of all, vectors can be added. Here's a vector v, there's a vector w. We can add them by putting them together like that to get the sum v plus w. And in coordinates, it's just component-wise addition. Another thing that vectors have is that we can define the quadrants of a vector. Because a vector is a directed line segment from one point to another, the quadrants is just the quadrants between the initial point and the final point. It doesn't make sense to talk about the quadrants of a point, only the quadrants between two points, but it does make sense to talk about the quadrants of a vector. So we're going to work with vectors and transformations of vectors, and these two properties of vectors are going to play a role. Let's have a look at the simplest possible transformations of vectors, which are dilations. Translations don't count because translations just keep vectors themselves to themselves. But dilations are very interesting. And here we have an example. So there's a Cartesian plane, and there's an object of interest, that red flower, which we'll call F. And to dilate the plane, we're going to expand or contract centered at the origin. So if we dilate by a factor of 2, the flower goes to this green one. Everything's expanded by 2, the center there. We can also dilate by a factor of 1/2, in which case the flower would shrink to that blue one there. Slightly more sophisticated idea is to dilate by minus 1. So that means that if we take any vector, say that vector joining here to here, instead of multiplying it by 2 or by 1/2, we multiply that vector by minus 1, which flips it over. So the dilate of this flower by minus 1 is this upside down flower that you see over here. Now there's a beautiful thing about dilations that connects dilations intimately to numbers. And that is that dilations can be composed, which turns out to be just like multiplying them, and they can be added. So for example, if we dilate by 2 and then we dilate by 3, that's the same as dilating first by 3 and then dilating by 2, and that gives a total dilation of 6. So the multiplicative structure of numbers is coming through in the composing of dilations. There's another example, dilate by 2, dilate by minus 1, you get dilate by minus 2. A somewhat different operation is addition. Let me explain that. So if we want to dilate by 2 and we dilate by 1/2 and we want to add those operations, what does it mean? Well, let's take the image of that point there, for example. If we dilate by 2, we see we get that point. If we dilate by 1/2, we get that point. Now, if we add these two vectors, if we add that vector and that vector, we get a bigger vector going up to about here. So the effect of adding the two dilations point-wise is to dilate by a little bit bigger, 2 1/2. So the additive structure of numbers is reflected here. The multiplicative structure is reflected there. So dilations are just like numbers in the additive and multiplicative structure. That's an important point, and it's going to be the basis for us extending these numbers to complex numbers. We're going to throw in something more than just dilations. We throw in rotations. All right, so now let's consider rotations of the plane, and we're going to always rotate about our center point, our center vector. There's the unit circle, okay? And a rotation has to preserve that circle, and more generally, rotations preserve quadrants of vectors. Let me remind you that a point on the circle is given by this parametric equation. So that's a typical point on the circle. Here's an example of a rotation where we've taken our flower and we've rotated it around, so now it's tilted over there, and we've rotated it by that amount there. Now, one obvious thing that you can do with rotations is that you can compose them. We can do a rotation like this, and then we can do another rotation, and we can do one after the other to get a multiplicative or composed rotation. However, rotations cannot be added. All right. So the way we're going to fix this is to enlarge our view to consider dilations and rotations together. So we're going to consider things which are, we'll call them rotation dilations. And it will turn out that a complex number is nothing more than a rotation dilation. That geometrically is what a complex number is. And it explains a lot of the magic and the mystery of complex numbers, if you look at it that way. So here's a picture that illustrates. So there's our starting picture. Got our flower, we also have now a little house to join it. Okay, we're going to do a rotation dilation to this thing. So to go from here to here, you can see that what we've done is we've done two things. We've rotated the picture, and we've also dilated it a little bit. Or if you like, we've dilated it and then rotated it. So to go from here to here, that's a transformation of the plane. And it's completely determined by where this little vector, 1, 0, goes. 1, 0 goes to the vector AB. We'll call that vector AB, which is arbitrary. Then the vector 0, 1 over here goes to vector minus BA. And everything else is determined from knowing this AB. So we'll say that this rotation dilation is a complex number Z, and we'll denote it by the vector AB. It's completely determined by AB. And an alternate notation is we'll say that Z equals A plus BI. So for now, this is just notation that represents this rotation dilation. So the remarkable thing about rotation dilations, which are complex numbers, is that there are two operations we can do with them. We can compose them, that is, do one after the other, and we still get a rotation dilation. And we can also add them. We can add them in the same way that we added dilations earlier, vector-wise or point-wise. And the point is we still get a rotation dilation. This happens only in two dimensions. It's a very special property about rotations and dilations in the plane. Okay. So in terms of our notation, A plus BI, here is what these two operations amount to. Okay. So the addition is just point-wise addition. So if you take that complex number and that complex number, then you sum to get the obvious complex number. That's the formula for multiplying complex numbers. Here's the basic relation. The most important fact about complex numbers is that the quadrants of V times the quadrants of W is the quadrants of V times W. That amounts to Fibonacci's identity. A squared plus B squared times C squared plus D squared equals this quantity squared plus this quantity squared. When we want to deal with pure rotations, well, then we're talking about points A, B, which are on the unit circle of this form. That's what we already said before. So these are pure rotations. There's also kind of a special one where Z infinity is equal to minus 1. And if we call this complex number ZT, and I'll leave it to you as an exercise, that ZT times ZR equals ZS implies that S is given by this formula. So this is how we multiply pure rotations. It's a great exercise. All right, so that's complex numbers. Next time, we're going to have a quiz. I hope you'll join me for that. I'm Norman Wildberger. Thanks for listening.